introduce yourself and everything that's awesome about Jefferson's.
You bet. Trey Zoeller, I'm founder, master blender, janitor, just about everything for, or I was, for most of the last 24 years for Jefferson's Bourbon. And I'll give you a little history of how I started and why I started and why we are named Jefferson's Bourbon and what appreciation I think we all share of Mr. Jefferson's. And we'll take it from there. But in the meantime, I'm going to pour myself a Jefferson's Ocean on the rocks. How many people are joining me? A lot of these tastings, we have bottles out there. I see some bottles being shown right now. Hopefully you do. If you don't, sorry, you're missing out. Or at least I think so. Haven't gotten too bad at it. All right. I think we're back on. Okay. So I'll give you a little history about how we got involved and why we named our company and our brand for Mr. Jefferson. And as Aaron alluded to earlier, you know, let's make this conversational. I will go ahead and tell you a little bit, but go ahead and start peppering us with questions if you have them. Grew up here in Kentucky. Like most people in Kentucky, grew up drinking bourbon. If you went to my grandmother's house, she didn't ask you what you like to drink. Rather, how do you take your bourbon? Everything she cooked with was smothered in bourbon. My eighth generation grandmother was arrested for moonshining and bootlegging in 1799, which makes her the first documented woman in the American whiskey business. So it was just kind of in my blood. So like most people here, it wasn't until I moved to about a half dozen different places around the country that I realized that bourbon wasn't prevalent everywhere. This was in the 80s. I moved to New Orleans first. I was in DC for a while. I was out west, Charleston. And I could always find Jim Beam, Wild Turkey, maybe Maker's Mark if I was lucky. And that was about it. It wasn't until I would come home for Thanksgiving or Christmas and I would drive past all these distilleries that I know were choked full of great old whiskey. And the reason I knew this is because the bourbon category was in a 30-year decline. So bourbon twice in our history, all other spirits combined to sell what bourbon did. But because of a couple different factors, first Prohibition, and then some hiccups with World War II, and then just kind of the bourbon falling out of favor in the 70s, it really reduced the demand for bourbon, which created this great supply. At the same time, single malt scotches had just come onto the market.
I think the scotch muted him again.
We whittled down, there was only eight distilleries when I started in the business. About the same time, my dad was on a Delta flight in the back of a Delta magazine. There was an ad to buy a barrel of Bushmills Irish whiskey. This was back in 1993. You could buy that barrel, and this is way before there were single barrel programs. You could buy that barrel in 1993, age it for 7 years, and on the millennial, that barrel would come of age, which was 25 years of age. He bought the barrel for the equivalent of $13.50 a bottle. When they bottled it up, it was worth about $250 a bottle. So one, I thought there might be a good business in here. And two, I thought what we had in Kentucky, bourbon was a much superior product to what was being bottled, aged and bottled in Scotland. So Scotch whiskey, I thought, was more of a watered down version of bourbon. Somebody just asked Roxer on the or neat. I drink mine on the rocks, but drink it any way you like it. So I went around and talked to all eight distillers in Kentucky and asked them if I could buy barrels of bourbon. They were more than happy to sell it to me because nobody else was buying it. That bourbon was continuing to age and the bourbon evaporated out of the barrel. So it would either evaporate until it was empty, or you had some of these great old barrels that were being blended into a four-year-old and were never being able to showcase how great some of these great, these, you know, unicorn barrels were, so to speak. So as I started going around and buying these barrels, and I was about the only one dumb enough to do it, I started getting calls at the end of every fiscal quarter of year saying, Trey, I've got 400 barrels of a 17-year-old, or I've got 500 barrels of a 16-year-old. Are you interested? I would say, send me some pricing and samples and we'll take a look at them. So I started buying up small esoteric lots of bourbon. And then after playing around with them, originally what we did is we came out with different brands. I first came out with a 15-year-old. Jefferson's Reserve was our first product. I came out with a 10-year-old, very different style, which was called Sam Houston. And the reason that I came up with these names for the products, one, I was in my 20s when I started the business, and bourbon was all about heritage and tradition. Two, what I was bottling up, I wanted to put a face to the style of whiskey that I was putting into the bottle. So our Jefferson's Reserve, obviously named for Thomas Jefferson, I thought was incredibly sophisticated, very complex. So I thought that was the perfect person to put out in front of our product. Sam Houston was a totally different style bourbon. It was very, I used to call it the kick your mother in the mouth bourbon. Had a ton of spice, it was high proof. It was not nearly as polished as the Jefferson's Reserve. So thus Sam Houston. It turns out that we've been known for being incredibly innovative, and that goes hand in hand with Thomas Jefferson. But it was a combination of putting a face to the name of the product inside, giving me a little of the gray hair, which I no longer need. It's kind of a tribute to what I thought this great American spirit was all about. Thomas Jefferson, as a lot of you guys probably know, was not a big fan of bourbon. He thought it was a little crude, being the big venophile that he is and a francophile. He was much more into what he thought were the finer things in life. That being said, he was very important to the whiskey movement in the United States. To give you a little history about why bourbon is proliferated in Kentucky, and 98% of it comes from Kentucky, or as our governor says, all of it that's worth a shit is from Kentucky and I wouldn't drink the other stuff. No offense to the few out in Virginia, but it was because all the whiskey was made up in Maryland, DC, Pennsylvania, New York, in that area. We fought a war because we didn't want to pay taxes to the British. And General Washington, who led that war, then became President Washington and had to pay for that war. So what did he do? He instilled the first tax in the United States. And being by far and away the largest distiller in America, he kind of took one for the team and made that first tax a whiskey tax. So there was a quick rebellion that our little army put down by all the distillers because they didn't want to pay a tax now that they just fought a war against it. So after that rebellion was squashed, most of the distillers went over the Appalachian Mountains or past the long arm of the tax man. So they could distill in Kentucky, Tennessee, Ohio, Indiana, and not have to pay taxes on it. All the whiskey at that time was coming right off the still and would have been consumed that way or put into a jug like this and was sold that way. When distillers that were on the western slope of the Appalachian Mountains tried to bring their product to market, the quickest, fastest, and easiest way to do that was put in the only containers that they had, which were bourbon barrels, or barrels, which weren't bourbon barrels at the time. Barrels carried everything, nails, soap, fish, you name it. But they put the bourbon in those barrels. And as legend has it, they charred the inside or put a flame inside the barrels in order to kill the flavor and taste that would have come out from those other items that they had carrying in those barrels. Then they would fill those barrels with bourbon and take it on a very treacherous journey. They would float it down the Ohio River to the Mississippi River, down to New Orleans, where they had pirates down there that were trying to steal their bourbon. Many of the ships sank or the boats sank. Once they got it to New Orleans, they traded it either for horses or gold and would either walk back or take those horses back to Kentucky. And that's supposedly where the horse business really got initiated and started, by bringing these Spanish horses back up into Kentucky. So the bourbon, or the whiskey at the time, was either served in New Orleans, a lot of it on Bourbon Street. Some people say that's where the name came from. The other reason that people call it bourbon, or claim that it came from, or is called bourbon, most of that bourbon was put on the river in what was called Bourbon County, Kentucky, named after Louis the 14th and the Bourbon family. But once it hit New Orleans, they would put it on ships and sail it around the Straits of Florida, up the East Coast, back to where the populace of the United States was, Baltimore, Philadelphia, New York, and Boston. So a little history of why bourbon really proliferated in Kentucky. It was Thomas Jefferson who, one, commissioned a still at every fort that he had. The Lewis and Clark expedition had lots and lots of bourbon, which they used to trade and pacify the Indians. And most importantly, Thomas Jefferson revoked the first whiskey tax. So he let the spirit proliferate yet a little bit more. So a little history of it there. We got into the business again, first buying these esoteric lots of bourbon. I started playing around with them. I realized that by blending them together, that the whole was better than the parts. I was able to get more balance and more complexity in it. So I started really blending bourbon originally. And it was when I was buying all these different lots of bourbon and talking to different distillers, they would tell me the same thing. Trey, 65 to 80% of what bourbon is, or the heart and soul of bourbon, comes from the maturation process. And I looked at it. Everybody was distilling it with a pretty similar recipe, and they were all aging it in the same manner. And I looked again to my dad, being a bourbon historian, and saw how they came to age bourbon the way they did, and it was all about practicality. So I looked at how we can manipulate the maturation process to bring more flavor or different flavors into it. So I'll tell you a little bit about the different products that we have now. And we had different, we have over 20 different expressions of Jefferson's bourbon. So as I said, I started sourcing from these old distilleries and had this old whiskey. Then I started contracting with them. So they started making bourbon for me to my specifications with my recipe, putting in the barrels that I specified for them. And then we would age them at our, either at their warehouses or our warehouses. And finally, we started distilling and aging our own. So it is still a combination that we use today. I still source when there's opportunities. I still contract with big distillers all around Kentucky. And then we're distilling our own. And this allows me a lot of flexibility, and it allows me to create what I call flavor racks, which gives us different flavors, or spice racks, I should say, which gives us different flavors that I can add in when I'm doing different blending exercises. So that's really how we got started. And then we kind of morphed along the way to start really getting into the innovation side of it, which again, looking and leaning into Thomas Jefferson for some of those, some of that direction. If you can see this picture right here, which I think you can. This is a blending day for me. Tuesday afternoons, the third Tuesday of every month, is when I start doing different blends for different batches. So two of our more popular bourbons are Jefferson's Very Small Batch, which someone earlier held up the bottle of the Very Small Batch, which has a full-length etching of Thomas Jefferson on the back is one that we blend to be very approachable, yet full-bodied. And then our Jefferson's Reserve is one that I blend, which is much older, that is all about complexity and balance and trying to get the bigger flavors out of it. Then we started playing around with the agitation and the maturation of the product. I'm going to stop right there because the question was, where do I find and what? How do we choose what to put on the bottle that is associated with Thomas Jefferson? One, that full length almost looks like a statue we have on our very small batch. And I think that's our third iteration of that as we've made him a little bit more pronounced. He got to be looking a little superhero figure-ish, so we kind of toned that down a little bit. We've got on our Jefferson's Reserve and our Jefferson's Twin Oak, kind of the emblem of Monticello on here. We've got kind of the profile of Thomas Jefferson as well. So it just depends on the product and how we wanted to present it, that we bring different facets of Thomas Jefferson's life in there. One of the products that I just held up right here, I told you that Thomas Jefferson was quite the venophile, and as he was ambassador to France, he traveled throughout the country quite a bit and visited a lot of chateaus, one of which his favorite was Chateau Pichon-Baronne in Bordeaux, that produced an unbelievable cab. It's a second growth cab right now. And he also visited Chateau Soutereau, which is a Sauternes that we finish in. On both of those products, we take 8-year-old bourbon that we distill here in Kentucky. And the reason that we grab these barrels, so we grab barrels from both of those chateaus because Thomas Jefferson visited the chateaus, wrote about them, wrote about the wines extensively, served them at the White House, and then cellared them at Monticello. So I thought it was kind of cool to bring this full circle. They, as soon as they dump those barrels, they send them to me. I put 8-year-old bourbon in them, and then I take them to what I call hot boxes here in Kentucky, which are no more than shipping containers. And I'll do that because on a hot day in the summer, where it may be 90 degrees in Kentucky, it's 130 degrees in those hot boxes. And those hot boxes will sweat out the product that was in there previously. So like the Bordeaux really comes out, gives it a great red hue, and you can also pick up those flavors. So from the Bordeaux Cabernets that we finish in, we get a lot of earthy tones, just like you would from a Bordeaux Cabernet. We also finish in two different Napa cabs, Napa Cabernets, first Groth and then Chapelet. We use the Pritchard Hill Cabernet, which brings out, you know, it's as earthy as the Bordeaux cabs, really influence the bourbon. The fruit that comes out of the Napa cabs, a lot of black cherry, a lot of chocolate, really comes through and can bring in a lot of different flavors. So again, those are some of the different aging techniques or maturation techniques that we use to bring and kind of expand and kind of make our bourbons a little bit more sophisticated. It's a good place to see if there's any questions. I've seen a number of them pop up, but talked right through them. Aaron, are there any that you want to get into now, or should we?
Yeah, let's look at some of the more recent ones that came in. So I think some of the more popular ones are in talking about the history of bourbon is first talking about what about the ingredients and the geography of Kentucky kind of separates bourbon from what else has been, you know, what you can create elsewhere in the U.S. And then I got a follow-up one after that one.
Okay. So again, whiskey was made really on the East Coast, and that was mainly a rye whiskey at the time. So when people came over the Appalachian Mountains, they started distilling whiskey mainly with the ingredients that were indigenous to the area. And corn was certainly the most readily available and the cheapest. Bourbon by law, and there are six laws that have been put into place to protect the integrity of what bourbon is. It actually makes bourbon the most expensive spirit to put into a bottle. And then I'll actually talk about some of the aging that there was a great article that was written last night that, that talks about why bourbon does not take nearly as long to age as other spirits. But one of the laws is it has to be at least 51% corn, no more than 79% corn. Two, it has to be aged in a new charred white oak barrel. So we can only use our barrels one time. After we use it once, we feel like we've extracted all the greatness that really makes a bourbon. We sell those barrels to Scotland to age Scotch, to Ireland to age Irish whiskey, to Mexico for tequilas, all over the world for rums. Any rum with color in it is aged in used bourbon barrels, most of it, or they're caramel colored. We can't add anything to the product. No caramel coloring, no vanilla extract, anything like that. All the color comes from the wood. As I said earlier, when it comes off the still, it's colorless like water, like vodka, like gin. It's when it's put into the barrel that we put a flame through it, that we do that, which opens up the barrel and allows the bourbon to penetrate in there further. One of the reasons that Kentucky is such a great place for maturing bourbon is because of the fluctuation in temperatures, not very different from where most people I saw on this call. If you don't like the weather, wait 5 minutes and it's going to change. We've got shitty weather for everything except for aging bourbon. It's the fluctuation of temperatures that make it such a great place. Because what happens as bourbon sits in a barrel in Kentucky like this, it waits for the temperature change. So as it gets hot, the molecules expand and push into the wood. When it gets cold, it contrasts again and comes back out. The more it goes in and out of the wood, it picks up flavor. Picks up color, which is evident, the most evident from viewing it, flavor. And also just as important, it takes out the astringency of the alcohol. It acts as a filter. So it adds mouthfeel. So it's not real thin. It really helps complete the product. Another reason that Kentucky is such a great place for it is our limestone water. We sit upon the largest limestone aquifer in the world. So our water is rated, just Louisville city water is rated one of the best waters in the world. But the whole region sits on this great aquifer, which makes it a very clean, basically the calcium acts as a filter taking out the calcium of the water. We have laws that dictate that we can't distill it higher than 160 proof. We can't put it into a barrel higher than 125 proof. It's got to be bottled at least 80 proof. So one with the new barrels, and then the time, money, of value that you put the whiskey down and age it, and then the rate of evaporation makes it the most expensive product to put into a bottle. So here in Kentucky, we lose 7 to 8% due to evaporation and absorption the first year, and then 3 to 4% every year afterwards. So about the 12, 13 year mark, you've lost half your product due to evaporation, and you've tied up your money for all that time. Now, the difference between Kentucky and Scotland, for instance, in Scotland, a barrel warehouse is the warmest place in the winter and the coolest place in the summer. It's like a cave. So you don't get that fluctuation of temperatures. And it's sitting in a used bourbon barrel, so that wood does not get absorbed into the whiskey as quickly. So it takes much longer. Most people will say for every 1 year in Kentucky, it's the equivalent of 4 years in Scotland. So those are some of the reasons that We think that Kentucky is the optimum place to make bourbon, although I do have some experiments going on that may question that. But it certainly, you know, I'm Scottish, so I can say this. What are the Scots known for? Being cheap. They use used barrels and they use grains that are less expensive. So that's why we think it's a superior product anyway. And you said you had a follow-up question to that?
Yeah, and it kind of goes on with that as well, because, and this is kind of weaving a couple questions into this, but you mentioned that you're innovating with a couple different new lines. What is it like being on the insider of the bourbon industry where you kind of can push at some of the traditions of how you make bourbon? You know, a couple questions we got is like, how is it a bourbon if you're reusing some old wine barrels? You know what I mean? Or like, where do, you know, you venture off and it's no longer considered a bourbon anymore, but it's still a really good whiskey. Like, what kind of goes into that process for you guys?
Well, so, and I kind of have a theory where I like to push the boundaries of what bourbon is without bastardizing it. So I'm always tipping my hat to the tradition of it. And I am not trying to cheat the process or accelerate it whatsoever. So, and again, when I started, there were 8 distilleries in the country. We were very much at the forefront of experimenting. Since that time, there's 2,800 distilleries in the country. And a lot of them, most of them are, the vast majority of them are smaller craft distilleries that have only been around a few years. So they have young whiskey. So they've tried to put in a lot of different techniques to try to accelerate that process. So going back to, say, finishing in wine barrels. Most people would say at 4 years of bourbon is fully matured. Now, to be bourbon, one of the things that I forgot to say, if it's younger than 4 years old, it's got to be stated on the label and it's got to be older than 2 years old. So at 3 years old, it's got to say 3 years old or 36 months on there. 4 years and above, you don't have to put an age statement on there. The youngest bourbon that we work with is 6 years old, and I put that in our barrel-aged Manhattan. Almost everything we do is at least 6 to 8 years old, which I have found to be the sweet spot to where it's fully matured, yet I can manipulate it to bring other flavors into it. So by finishing in wine barrels that I've aged already for typically 8 years at that point, then what I'm doing is adding more time, money, and effort into it in order to massage it to bring different flavors into it. So again, it's not cheating the process or accelerating the process. It's just layering on top of. So that's
very cool. Very cool. And then the other popular question we're getting to is the history of the ocean, where that comes in and what's sort of the background on what creates the ocean line.
So it was about 2008. Let's see. About 2008, I had two aha moments. One, I went to Independent Stave Company, which is by far and away the largest cooperage for bourbon barrels. A cooperage is a place that they make bourbon barrels, and it's a cooper is very much a crafted skilled laborer that there's a long apprenticeship to. I'd been to the one in Kentucky countless times, and with bourbon barrels, we typically have a barrel that has 4 levels of char. 1 being the lightest, 4 being the deepest. And again, that char is just a big flame going through the barrel. The longer the char, the more porous the barrel becomes, the more porous the barrel becomes, the deeper the whiskey can get in there. Detriment of a bigger char is it doesn't allow secondary flavors to come through. It gets masked by that char. I was invited back for Independent Stave Company's 100th year anniversary to their home office in Missouri. and they've got cooperages all over the world. So they make wine barrels and spirit barrels for people everywhere. And I was invited to be a barrel chef for a couple of days. So being a barrel chef, basically I watched a computer screen in front of me and I threw either more kindling on or sprayed it down following a graph of time and temperature to, that would evoke different flavors, whether it's butterscotch flavors or mocha flavors, vanilla flavors. So I saw all these different techniques that they were using for different wines and spirits. And I thought, why are we so rudimentary in bourbon that we don't take advantage of the slow cooking and the searing and the using different staves at different times and temperatures to bring out different flavors? So I started experimenting with those. And this is another thing that we do, like our Twin Oak right here. I take 10-year-old bourbon, and then I put it in a barrel that I've developed over the last 8 years, over hundreds of different experiments of using these different barrels with different variations on them, to where I've come up with a proprietary barrel where we extra season it, meaning we leave it out in the lumber yard for an exorbitant amount of time. We groove it out so it looks like a Lay's potato chip. Excuse me, a Ruffles potato chip, which gives it twice as much surface area. Twice as much surface area, touches the whiskey twice as much, and you can get more flavors out of it. Then we put a flash char on it just to open it up, and then we toast it at a certain time and temperature to bring out mocha flavors. So you get these deep mocha flavors that come out of this product after being double barreled into it. So one, we use our original barrel, then we put it into new barrels, which one, the biggest expense of bourbon is the barrels. And then we manipulated all those different ways to bring out the flavors. So that was one thing I saw. This is when I really thought maturation's it. And then at the same time, I was invited down to my friendship in Costa Rica. A buddy of mine, Chris Fisher, who owned a ship at the time called Ocean. That ship is now called O-Search, where he catches tags and releases great white sharks in order to, and he invites all these scientists down upon it. He's actually got 51 papers being written from his ship as we speak right now. I was with him in the Bahamas 2 weeks ago. We went down there, we fished, we surfed, and we drank a lot of bourbon. As we sit on the bow of the ship drinking bourbon, I saw the bourbon in the glass and in the bottle sloshing back and forth. And I thought, if this is continuously sloshing back and forth, instead of sitting like this waiting for the temperature to change, this is certainly going to change the maturation process. So I said to Chris, hey, let's put some barrels on your ship and see what happens. He suggested that might not be such a good idea since his crew catches great white sharks. But the more he drank, the more he came up with a great idea. Let's put some barrels on this ship. So it was twofold. One, I wanted to see what the hell would happen to the whiskey. Two, he was taking off for a 7-year journey at the time, and he was going to go hit all these exotic ports of call. And I had an excuse to go visit them all over the world and drink whiskey. So I made sure we got these barrels on the ship. But he took off. He changed his expedition, ended up going through the Panama Canal over to this uninhabited island chain called the Guadalupe Islands, which are 1,200 nautical miles southwest of San Diego. So being uninhibited, I couldn't go over there and visit them. But it bounced around there for 3.5 years. I had forgotten about the barrels, to be honest, until after 2 years on a ship, I got a call from him. He said, Trey, I've got bad news. We only put 5 barrels on there. 2 of the 5 barrels, the bands have corroded and burst. I've got my own theory on that. I know the crew. They knew a little bit more about this whiskey when we finally tasted it than anyone. So I call those 2 barrels Juan's share. Juan was one of the crewmen that really knew about that whiskey. But nonetheless, he brought his ship back after 3.5 years for repairs in Key West. So I went down and met him. I brought some journalists from the New York Times, Esquire and Men's Health. Hadn't tasted it, didn't know anything about it. We tapped into the barrels. And I told you that whiskey came off the still colorless. That bottle in the middle was 3.5-year-old bourbon. And that's flanked by 10-year-old bourbon. So you can see how dark it got. It got dark. It got very viscous. It was like syrup, and it was absolutely delicious. So we sent a barrel back to the cooperage to have it reverse engineered and figured out there were three things that happened. One, you had constant contact with the barrel. So it picked up more color, it picked up more flavor, and it used that barrel as a filter that took out the astringency of the alcohol. So when you try this, you'll notice it goes down extremely easy. Two, today we cross the equator four times. And as we get exposed to that extreme heat, it caramelizes the sugars in the wood. Cooper's had never seen caramelization like this in wood. So that extreme caramelization makes it very viscous and gives it that big caramel flavor. And three, when that ships out in the middle of the ocean, that sea air permeates the barrel, gives it a salty flavor. So actually, my favorite brown water society, the Charleston Brown Water Society, dubbed it early on the salted caramel popcorn bourbon, because you get that salted flavor from the brininess, you get the caramel from the caramelization, the sugars, and that popcorn, it's a little bit of that wood that's being just battered the whole time. So it was a really unique tasting bourbon. What we do today is we take 6 to 8-year-old bourbon, we put them in cradles, and then put those cradles in containers, and we put those containers in, on small container ships. We're contracted to be on the very top of the bow of the ship, so we get as much pitch as possible. We also have cut out kind of big sunroofs in it, so it's very exposed to the elements. The sun's beating down on it. It's getting rained on, snowed on, and then obviously rocked around. So today we put, so each voyage has approximately 400 barrels on them. We go from Kentucky down to Savannah, out the port of Savannah, down through the Panama Canal, over to Australia, New Zealand, around Australia, down into the Tasmanian Sea, back up Indonesia, China, Japan, over to Tacoma, Washington, down the West Coast, back through the Panama Canal, up the East Coast, over into the North Sea, bounces around a few ports in Europe, comes back down the East Coast into Savannah and back up. So it hits 30 different ports on 5 different continents, crossing the equator 4 times. So it really is it's a whiskey better traveled than most people, widely traveled, I should say. So looking at that, I thought, the reason that bourbon proliferated, the reason that people in Baltimore, Philadelphia, New York, Boston would pay so much more for this bourbon that came from Kentucky and kept ordering it from Kentucky, and why bourbon blew up in Kentucky, was not because bourbon tastes the way it does today, but because it tastes a lot more like Jefferson's Ocean does. And to back that up, a couple of years ago, I put 2 barrels on, it took us 4 different boats. I tried to do it historically accurate as possible. So we distilled these 2 barrels in the winter, waited until the spring floods would have subsided, floated the barrels down the Ohio River down to New Orleans. It took us 58 days, got to New Orleans, transferred it to another boat. As soon as we did that, tropical storm hit, rotated around New Orleans for 8 days. We got the barrels over to Tampa Bay just in time to hide out. Hurricane Joaquin hit, buckled the staves on the barrel head. I had to put new barrel heads on it in Tampa Bay. We finally got it down to Key West. I had to ship new barrels down, siphon the juice out of the original barrels into new barrels in Key West. Got it up to Fort Lauderdale. We had a boat coming over from the BVIs that got destroyed by Hurricane Matthew. So we wintered in Fort Lauderdale, basically hitchhiked a ride up to New York, landed the day that we took off. We had four boats, three big storms. And what landed was bourbon that was about a year and a half old at the time, was darker than a 16-year-old bourbon, and absolutely the smoothest whiskey I've ever had. Smooth isn't always the best, but it was unbelievably smooth. So it just, it kind of reinforced my hypothesis, was it wasn't necessarily the weather that we had in Kentucky and with the limestone water, rather the journey that that whiskey went on. And again, people were drinking whiskey right off the still up in the areas that I talked about. So it perpetuated the bourbon, really blew up in Kentucky because of the journey that it took and the maturation and the agitation that it had that was so much different. So today we just bottled up our 23rd voyage of Jefferson's Ocean. We've got three types: our typical voyage, which is a rye bourbon. So there's two types of bourbon. Typically you've got rye as a small grain or wheat as a small grain. So we've got the rye voyage, which is our normal voyage. We have a cask strength version of that. So it comes, whatever the, what comes right out of the cask, we bottle that up. And we also do a wheated recipe once a year, which is softer, which unlike the rye, which is very soft or very spicy, this allows for more of that brininess to come out, more of the caramelization to come out. So it's kind of amplified more so than the regular voyages. So.
That's awesome. Now, I remember when I was in Louisville, learning about the Ocean's distilling process, I was blown away. And I'm looking at the comments right now, and it seems like everyone is pretty much there as well. I guess sort of the last question I have for you, Trey, before I'll probably open this up to let people kind of fire some of the ones that I've been missing is, compared to when you started to where the bourbon industry now, it's been an explosion. Where do you see the bourbon industry going, both in terms of creativity, but also maybe just in terms of size over like the next decade?
It's completely upside down from where I started. For instance, I bought 400 barrels. This is back about 2010. I paid less per barrel for what I poured, or what I paid the other day for one pour of it. Say the other day, this is just prior to COVID, for one of our sales guys. I paid $1,200 a barrel, and they were charging $1,350 per pour of it. So, you know, you can see that it's just, it was turned on its head. I went to the first whiskey fest with my friends, the Van Winkles, and we had a deal. You could buy five cases of Pappy Van Winkle and get a case of Jefferson's Reserve, no charge, or five cases of Jefferson's Reserve and get a case of Pappy Van Winkle, no charge. And it was mainly retailers that were there. We didn't sell 10 deals between the two of us. We couldn't give it away. Now, I used to work with UVA's Alumni Association 10 years ago, where we did a lot of bottled, especially for you programs, private label programs. We had to stop that because we can't keep up with demand. So now we're at a point where we're building up enough demand, and hopefully we can get together and start doing those programs again. But bourbon's just, you know, it's exploded now. I used to take bottles of bourbon to friends' parties around the country and would go unopened. And now it's the first one that's consumed. So where is it going? Well, there's a lot of speculation of where it's going. I think you'll continue to see finishing being very much on the forefront of it. I think you'll see people seeing what direction they can go in. There's a lot of work right now on kind of terroir, indigenous grains, you know, different types of corns and ryes. So they'll keep exploring it out. And that's all a great thing. There's certainly a time and a place for traditional bourbons, and there's plenty of bourbons out there that can satisfy that. I think our Jefferson's Reserve is the most quintessential bourbon. It packs in so many of the really big traditional bourbon flavors.
That's awesome. That was kind of the last question I had from at least my perspective and, you know, what I've been kind of chatting through the chat. I know we're coming up on time. So if anyone has a hot date at 7 p.m., don't let us keep you any longer. But Michael, what I was thinking about doing is maybe opening it up for everyone who wants to hang on to ask any questions to Trey directly. I'm sure we'll get everyone talking at one time, because that always happens whenever this happens here as well. But Trey, would you be open to that? Is fielding a question from the audience? All right, cool.
Yeah, absolutely. Hey. I will say one thing. I know we've got a deal with Reserve Bar. So it's a website that you can order barrel or bottles on it. We've got a code for free shipping and $5 off per bottle, I think it is. Liz, if you're on here, if you can give those codes or put them up, that'd be great.
Yep. And we're going to follow up with an email for those. So for the codes for ordering any sort of Jefferson's product, as well as the discount codes to use for a free tour and tasting whenever everyone's going through Louisville to see this in person as well. So we'll be sure to communicate all of that, as well as pick our raffle winner afterwards as well, too.
You got it. We're open Wednesday through Sunday right now. So we're open during COVID. Come on, see us.
I appreciate everyone jumping on and joining us today. Based on all the comments I've seen in here, this has been super informative, and everyone really has enjoyed the presentation that you gave, Trey. So on behalf of all the clubs represented here, we really appreciate you taking the time on an evening night to talk about your love and everything about Jefferson's. For everyone who is on the call, we'll be following up with the details about the way that you can come visit Trey and see the distillery whenever you're in Louisville, as well as the discounts we're doing through Reserve Bar in case you want to stock back up on your Oceans and all the other lines that are there. But Trey, thanks so much, man. This is awesome. I know that we all really enjoyed this, and we look forward to doing some more events again. Yeah. And now we have the recording so that when your son applies to UVA, we can just attach this to his file online and use that to grease the wheels.
Yeah, you bet. That'd be amazing. And I also like to say, when we send that out, we'll also have a link. If anybody wants to order a bottled especially for label with names on there, we can send those out to you, and then you can purchase bottles and apply them yourself. So fantastic. Awesome. Thank you. I appreciate it very much. And go Hoos.
Go Hoos.